Good evening. Tonight, I'm changing my name from Snakebite Bill to the Boondock Scientist. It's kind of like a shade tree mechanic, a shade tree physicist, or a shade tree anything. We're going to look at the subject of the atomic bomb, the original atomic bomb, which they called the Gadget. This picture you're looking at right here is the very first atomic bomb, the Gadget. You're gonna see on this photo a lot of cabling. The important thing here was that the electrical length of each cable would appear the same, and when they fired the device, all of them would fire at the same time. And actually, the way this was done was there was a bunch of sparks would light off the beginning of the sequence of explosions. And this had to be very, very focused so that everything could compress down to the core and create a critical mass. This bomb, very complicated. They had a lot of problems with it, with the device for the first tests. But nonetheless, it did work. And they were fortunate enough to have it work at 5:30 a.m. on July 16th. 1945. Los Alamos scientists detonated the plutonium bomb at a test site located on the U.S. Air Force Base at Alamogordo, New Mexico, some 120 miles south of Albuquerque. Oppenheimer chose the name Trinity for the test site, inspired by the poetry of John Donne. The test had been scheduled for 4 a.m., but when the time came, it was raining and the appointed hour was pushed back to 5:30. Tensions ran high at the test site, where those assembled included the scientist Enrico Fermi, who had directed the first nuclear chain reaction in December 1942, U.S. Army Brigadier General Leslie Groves, Bush, Oppenheimer, and others. When the bomb was finally detonated atop a steel tower, an intense light flash and a sudden wave of heat was followed by a great burst of sound echoing in the valley. A ball of fire tore up into the sky and then was surrounded by a giant mushroom cloud stretching some 40,000 feet across. With a power equivalent to around 21,000 tons of TNT, the bomb completely obliterated the steel tower on which it rested. The nuclear age had begun. This is a photograph of the Trinity test that happened on 16 July 1945. It was the first detonation of a nuclear weapon ever. This test and the resulting success of the Trinity test changed the way that the world will go to war forever. As you can see, the small mushroom cloud, I say small, because today's weaponry has the ability to destroy much more and produce much larger explosions, mushroom clouds, and ultimately destruction of our atmosphere and quite possibly the world. What we are looking at here is Ground Zero in Hiroshima. This structure survived and was not torn down because the Japanese wanted to create a memorial for the destruction and the loss of 80,000 lives. Those 80,000 lives were lost immediately. After that, because of radiation poisoning and the keloids that developed on the skins and the tumors, they built a museum. I have been to that museum in 1970. It's very interesting. When an American visits the museum and you sign the guest log, all kinds of people gather around to see what comments you left. I was in the military then, stationed in Iwakuni, Japan, at the Marine Corps Air Station. I taught conversational English to Japanese businessmen in Hiroshima. I belonged to the Japanese American Cultural Friendship Society, and that's how I got to do the wonderful job of helping Japanese business people speak conversational English. However, you don't want to be there late at night. You want to be on the train back out of town, because at that time there were still lots of wounded, crippled people on the streets and stuff, and there were certain areas of Hiroshima they didn't want to see an American's face. During the month of August, Hiroshima was off limits to us military folks because of the hatred that was generated in our direction, with good reason, I might say. The attack on Pearl Harbor had no comparison to Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Also, people don't realize this, but more lives were lost in the firebombing of Japanese cities than to the atomic bomb. The photograph of the bomb we are looking at here is known as Little Boy. This was the bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima. The bomb was set to detonate at 1,600 feet, creating an airburst that would do the most damage to the city. Had the bomb gone off at ground level, it would be a lot less damage. But this bomb had radar altimeters and a lot of electronic capability that you wouldn't expect to be happening or to be used in 1945. But this is Little Boy, the first bomb used, the first atomic bomb used in anger. The bomb we are looking at here is at the Air Force Museum. It is called Fat Man. It's a different type of bomb, but it delivered about the same yield, maybe a little more than Little Boy. But it had been compromised because of the target. The original target was clouded over, and the bombardier on the B-29 could not get an accurate fix of where to release the bomb. So they went to Nagasaki, dropped the bomb, and it killed about 40,000 people. The two bombs were different in construction and detonation, and that will be gone into a little later. Just want you to see the difference between Fat Man and previously Little Boy. What we are looking at here is Bikini Atoll in the Marshall Islands. They took all the residents off, put them somewhere else, and for a good many years did a lot of above ground atomic bomb testing. You will see out there in the bay ships at anchor. This was filmed and refilmed to try to quantify the destructive power of the different bombs that we were creating. I happened to have the pleasure of meeting a physicist who worked at Duke University in his swan song years, who was a safety officer at Bikini Atoll. He had quite a story to tell. Bikini Atoll and a Weetok Atoll, a necklace of coral islands in the Marshall Islands, was subjected to repeated nuclear testing campaigns by the U.S. government from 1946 to 1958. Since then, Congress has funded a program to compensate veterans and their families $75,000 who participated in these atmospheric nuclear tests, who subsequently acquired a covered cancer as a result of exposure to the radiation. The U.S. tested more than 20 nuclear devices at Bikini Atoll and nearby Eniwetok Atoll. Massive quantities of radioactive waste are buried under a concrete dome in the Marshall Islands. They are the toxic remains of U.S.-led nuclear testing conducted in the 1950s and 1960s. The important participants of the project. Albert Einstein's involvement. Many people refer to Albert Einstein as the inventor of the bomb. But this is actually very far from true. Apart from coming up with the relativity theory, E equals mc squared, stating that a small amount of matter could release a lot of energy. Albert Einstein's only involvement in the development of this weapon of mass destruction was to sign a letter urging the US to develop the bomb. This was a decision Einstein, as a pacifist, had great regrets about. Physicists Eugene Wigner and Leo Szilard convinced Einstein to sign the letter because they knew that Germany had managed to split the uranium atom, and they were fearing that Germany was already working on an atomic bomb. Julius Robert Oppenheimer. Oppenheimer was the leader of the scientific team in the Manhattan Project and is often called the father of the atomic bomb. Yet again, he was not the sole inventor of the bomb, but its invention was the result of the collaboration among his team members, many of which were also exiles from Europe. Rewriting military policy around the globe. The scientists working on this project had one goal: developing an atomic superweapon that would help the US secure victory over the Axis powers during World War II. This project came as a result of Albert Einstein learning that Germany was developing atomic weapons. As we have learned before, Einstein relayed this critical information in a letter known as the Einstein Letter to President Franklin Roosevelt, and soon thereafter, development of the atom bomb was elevated to the highest priority national security project. The secret atomic weapons development project, dubbed the Manhattan Project, was launched in December 1941. Several hundred scientists were called to a laboratory in Los Alamos, New Mexico, to aid the United States in developing the atomic bomb, with the below individuals having the most notable roles in the project. J. Robert Oppenheimer. He was an American theoretical physicist that is widely renowned as the father of the atomic bomb. Oppenheimer was born in 1904, and his profound intelligence could be observed in his early academic achievements, like being invited to lecture at the New York Mineralogical Club at the age of 12, and graduating from Harvard with a degree in chemistry in just 3 years. Following his graduation, Oppenheimer pursued graduate study in physics under Max Born, a highly distinguished theoretical physics professor from Germany. After receiving his doctorate in 1927, Oppenheimer returned to the United States, where he worked as a physicist until eventually being sought out to lead the Manhattan Project. He was chosen by the United States Army to manage the laboratory that aimed to weaponize atomic energy, and was given a budget of $2 million as the Army recognized the importance of developing an atomic weapon before Germany. Leo Szilard. Leo Szilard was a Hungarian physicist that worked closely with Einstein to draft the aforementioned Einstein letter to President Roosevelt that prompted the president to establish the Manhattan Project. He earned a degree in physics at the University of Berlin alongside Albert Einstein. Szilard did most of his early work and research in Germany, but as the National Socialist German Workers Party, otherwise known as the Nazi Party, began to gain control over the nation, Szilard grew wary and departed Europe. Szilard tried to convince his colleagues that the possibility of harnessing atomic energy was a potential danger, and when German scientists discovered neutron-induced fission of uranium in 1939, his concerns were further validated. Hans Bethe. Hans Bethe was born in Strasbourg, Alsace-Lorraine in 1906, and served as chief theoretical division for the Manhattan Project after leaving Germany following the rise of the Third Reich. As one of the most important theoretical physicists of his generation, Bethe was responsible for discovering several crucial aspects of physics that made the atomic bomb possible. For instance, he showcased that the reaction that occurs in the heart of massive stars, the chemical process that gives off heat and energy, is nuclear fusion. With this theory in mind, he proposed several ways that hydrogen nuclei could be fused with helium nuclei, which proved to be fundamentally important to the completion of the atomic bomb, while also expanding the science of nuclear fission and fusion. In addition to this, Bethe helped the Manhattan Project team develop the formula needed for calculating the explosive yield of an atomic bomb, as well as assisted with creating the formula for calculating the critical mass of uranium-235, the radioactive material found in the earliest atomic bombs and used against Hiroshima in 1945. Ernest O. Lawrence. Ernest Lawrence is an American-born nuclear physicist who participated in the Manhattan Project after receiving his doctorate degree from the University of California, Berkeley, in 1928. Before being chosen for the atomic project, Lawrence focused his attentions on founding the academic research laboratories that would allow him to strongly pursue advancements in nuclear physics. In these labs, Lawrence invented the cyclotron in 1929. This device accommodated the acceleration of nuclear particles to velocities high enough to disintegrate atoms and form new elements without using high voltage currents. This technology grew more powerful over time and was useful in the production of the atomic bomb. As a program chief of the Manhattan Project, Lawrence was given domain over research concerning the electromagnetic separation of atoms to be used in the atomic bomb. Klaus Fuchs. Klaus Fuchs, a German theoretical physicist, was a notorious spy working for the Soviet Union who was embedded within the Manhattan Project. Prior to the ascension of the Third Reich, Fuchs fled Germany. Fuchs was interned in Quebec as a German refugee for a short time in 1940. But after his release, he became a British citizen in 1942. When the British selected their delegation of scientists to participate in the Manhattan Project, Fuchs was on the list. However, during his time with the program, Fuchs delivered atomic secrets to the Soviets. Even though he delivered information to the Soviets, his work on Fuchs contributed many important theories to the development of the atomic bomb, such as helping develop the means needed to implode the critical fissionable core within the first atomic bomb designs. His work on one of the initial implosion atomic bombs, codenamed Fat Man, which was used to destroy Nagasaki, was praised by the United States Army. Due to his accomplishments, Fuchs was granted high-level security clearance and explicit access to many of the key details of the Manhattan Project. However, Fuchs' long-harbored communist sympathies came to a head, leading him to deliver detailed secrets about the energy yield of atomic explosion, implosion methods, and the Trinity test that occurred in July 1945. Some experts estimate that the information that Fuchs delivered enabled the Soviet Union to develop their own atomic bombs at least 1 year sooner than would otherwise be expected. In 1949, Fuchs was ousted as a spy and sentenced to 14 years in prison, though he only served 9. Mutual assured destruction. In theory, under mutual assured destruction, a nuclear attack by one superpower will be met with an overwhelming nuclear counterattack by their target using early warning systems, automated missiles, airborne nuclear bombs, and missile-armed hidden submarines. This will lead to the complete destruction of both. As such, mutual assured destruction, often abbreviated as MAD, is part of the military strategy of deterrence, in which one adversary threatens another with a reprisal if they attacked first. This final slide is a graphic representation of mutually assured destruction. If you notice the quote, "If you kill us, we'll kill you." I think that's kind of appropriate. It's like, if you don't come to my funeral, I won't come to yours. So there we have it, folks. I hope I was able to impart a few pearls of wisdom upon everybody. I don't know how the heck to get this to Vladimir Putin and that guy that's behind the curtain here in the U.S. will never come out and see it, so, because we don't know who it is. Okay, folks, you know, in the other channel, it's Snakebite Bill. But here, it's just the boondock scientist.